We are back in studio here on TTT. I have two wonderful people in studio I'll be chatting with in just a second. But coming up in the next part of the show, we have some guests already in studio. We have Glenroy McIntosh, who will be telling us about Connection, and Jonathan Bagan, our leader of Now, who will be talking to Rishi. But right now, on my table with me, I have Vincent Lopez, your filmmaker, and Cassandra Joseph, producer, fresh out of the Trinidad and Tobago Film Festival, guys. And you're here. But the reason I really am excited about chatting with you this morning is that your film is in Patois, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it's called Vue Café.
Vue Café.
Vue Café. Real coffee.
Is that what Vue means?
Real coffee.
Vue Café. Nice. And it's a V-W-E with an accent
on it, yes.
That's the acute accent.
Yes, you have to you have to enunciate it properly.
Vue Café, real coffee. Why is it called real coffee?
Well, actually, because it's the only part of Trinidad right now where, and the only person in Trinidad right now who actually plants, harvests, grinds his own coffee manually. Mm-hmm. And there's no additive system. So when you pound it, you grind it, and you taste it, that means like no other.
Yes.
And people want to buy it, but it's, you know. It's
and where is he located?
This is in Paramin.
Not up on the top.
Yeah, up on the hill. So yes. It's all done by him by hand. He's 95 years old and he's doing it still.
Still 95 years old.
Stronger than you and I sometimes because that pestle is very heavy and I kind of wonder how he gets wrong.
So you guys documented this process with him?
Yes, her grandfather.
My grandfather.
So you are from Paramin?
I am from Paramin. His name is Bertrand Joseph, locally known as Pin in the community. And he does all of these traditional things that I realize when I go out, people don't do, or other families don't do.
Like so, what, for example?
Like that, like I would wake up in the morning to pound.
Is this at 6 o'clock? You say no.
It's probably half five in the morning. You know, I would wake up to this pounding.
Yeah.
Or, you know, he would
and
be
is he
making
coffee.
Yeah. He's making coffee or he's making his own cocoa. Or sometimes he still makes his own brooms. So I tell a story that we have never bought a broom in my life growing up.
And are these like old-fashioned coquille brooms? Or?
It's not a coquille broom.
No.
So like everybody would have like pink, yellow, green brooms. You know, you're going to grocery and you see all these different colors. And I'm like, why do we have this bland, ugly broom? Why? You know, I never understood why.
Yes.
But actually,
it's tradition.
Right, so that would be an insult to him to buy a broom because it was passed on from generations. So he still makes his own broom. It's something called Latané.
Yes.
Right? And this Latané palm, it grows on the northern range. And you'll find it like on the outskirts. So like Maracas, Las Cuevas, Paramin, you'll find this Latané palm. It's a palm.
And we were just seeing footage of, well, I believe that would have been Paramin, but we were looking at footage of your grandfather actually making his coffee. How long is the video? How long is the film?
It's about 16 minutes.
16 minutes, yes.
It took, actually, that was all done in about 3 to 4 hours because he's up early.
Yeah.
And you have to get there and try and get it. And I mean, we've undone it because he has no time to wait on you. And most of the time, he should any other tell him stuff and go do it over because he's doing what he needs to do.
And doing it so fast.
He has no time
at
to wait on
a particular piece.
Can you do any of what he's doing? Has it been passed on to your generation?
We would look at him doing it, but honestly, Lisa, I have never, like I've helped once or twice, but to say like if I've actually done the entire process by myself, no. And I don't think anybody else in the family does it either.
Well, you did your job, at least you documented it for posterity, yes?
Yeah.
What's next for the film? Where do you go from here?
Well, the idea, we were trying to look at things that in Paramin that is still and only being done in Paramin.
Yeah.
And so far we just bring some of the few things and in terms of the community, what happens there, because a lot of things in Paramin is done in the community. You seldom hear about it outside of it. I think she could explain to you a little bit more about the things that they tend to do more since she's living there. And I'm just passing through.
You're not from Paramin?
No, I'm from Trinidad, Paramin, outside it.
Okay, so we have, like, living with him, I can tell you, like, you know, besides the cocoa and coffee making and his own broom making, he still does. Like he would preserve like something you would call it like cornfish, where you preserve fish or meat, where you smoke it. It's like the old Amerindian tradition.
Yes.
So part of Paramin history as well is, you know, we have some Carib heritage, apart from the Creole as well. So he still does things like that. I want to get that on film as well.
Yeah.
Right? And then also because of the Creole influence, we also have something called we have a patois mass. it's usually every February, and also in October as well, we have like an International Creole Day.
Yes.
And during this time, we would wear traditional wear. So like, just the same way like Indian people have, or East Indian, sorry, people have saris, and African people have dashikis, people do not know that, you know, Paraman Creole people, they wear something called driats.
Is right? that right?
They wear driats, and it used to be like flowered.
Yes.
And then you wear a head tie that is plaid, mm-hmm. Madras plaid actually. And
is
now,
that from the French heritage?
It is. With the French Creole.
One tete, mm-hmm.
Correct.
And two
tete. Correct.
Oh, of course. Yeah, they do that in Martinique and Guadeloupe
and Saint Lucia
as well.
And Saint Lucia,
right.
So
yes.
That's why we have the International Creole Day in October as well to commemorate that we are a part of this Creole history
but
as well.
We're going to find a way to include that on the program. But mm-hmm. before we wrap, I want to say congratulations on Bwe Cafe. And you know, I know that obviously I have a film bias and we've been having a number of filmmakers come through.
Yeah.
But what is important is what when you do work like this, you preserve the culture, you help strengthen the identity,
that's the intention.
And you also ensure institutional memory.
Yeah.
So it's not just about doing a film and you show it and you know,
it was more
film.
Along the lines of that. They're not just doing a film because we realize if he passes on, then nobody else probably would be doing that.
Yes,
so yeah, just to get as much as his, you know, input.
Also preservation of the language. Instead of shooting, my first film I did in English and then after that I said, you know what, because this is my third at Goody Festival, I want to do it in Creole,
Patois. All right, well, I want to thank you very much, Vincent and Cassandra, for coming on the program. It's called Bwe Cafe. We have to look out and get information from you as to how people can see it after the festival because it's over. But right now, we go to your local weather. Up next with Ian Wallace.